I'm Melissa Wilson. I'm at Arizona State University in the School of Life Sciences and affiliated with the Biodesign Institute and the Center for Evolution in Medicine. So as a part of that center, I've gotten involved in additional projects to really understand how evolution may have shaped some predispositions to disease. Please feel free to contact me on Twitter or email, however you like. So we'll just jump in. Usually I would tell you all to interrupt me, but that gets difficult in the online space. So I will try to keep track of time well and make sure to leave plenty of time for questions at the end. So the first thing I like to go over is that when we talk about sex differences, we use the same language to refer to a lot of different things. When I study sex differences, predominantly, I'm interested in the sex chromosome complement. So in humans, sex is largely determined by genetics. So the sex chromosome complement, or two X chromosomes in individuals that typically develop ovaries and make eggs, or an X and a Y chromosome in individuals that typically develop testes and make sperm. But some people may just be interested in the gametes when they're talking about sex differences. They may be more interested in the gonads and gonadal hormones, so thinking about androgens and estrogens and how they're circulating through the system. Or they may be interested or only able to collect self-reported gender. And we often let these overlap, and they do overlap significantly. But today, I want to try to focus in on the genetic component in particular. And I'm just acknowledging that the language overlaps dramatically. What's also really important is that when people talk about sex differences, it makes it seem as if it's bimodal, but in every possible way, it is not. So even when thinking about genetics, although we typically classify people into those that have two X chromosomes and those that have an X and a Y, those sex chromosome complement numbers are not the only that we find commonly across human populations. So individuals with a single X chromosome called Turner syndrome are about 1 in 2,500 live assigned female at birth, and individuals with two X chromosomes and a Y and developed testes as defined as Klinefelters, and that's about 1 in 500 people. So we can have this distribution in terms of chromosomal genetics, in terms of smaller scale gene variants that affect sex development. We have wide ranges in gonadal hormones. These not only vary based on your sex chromosome complement, but based on the age that we're looking at. So gonadal and reproductive hormones change across the lifespan. Gonad development changes. So these sex differences are multidimensional, and I think that's wonderful. It just means the problem is not bimodal. It's just a lot more wonderful and complicated than that. So thinking about that, one of the things that has been observed is that there are significant and consistent sex differences in human diseases. And one of the things that being a part of the Center for Evolution and Medicine allowed me to do was to work with these wonderful people. So Haney Natri actually did her PhD studying fish sex chromosome genetics and came to work with me and is now on doing wonderful things in California. Largely as a geneticist, Angela Garcia is a postdoc who was and does study psychosocial stress and its effect on hormone levels. Ben Trumbull is an anthropologist who studies industrialized and non-industrialized populations, and Ken Buteau came to ASU from the National Cancer Institute. So we all kind of got mashed together, and together we're thinking about how could have evolution shaped underlying differences to lead to the observed sex differences we observe in human populations? And we came up with the pregnancy compensation hypothesis, or the pregnancy pickle, which is a hill I would die on any day. I would choose that title again every day of the week. But let me get to why we think pregnancy is so important for shaping immune sex differences. So I'm going to talk a little bit about theory first, and then I'm going to dig into the genetics and a little bit more of how we use bioinformatics to address this question. For me, one of the most important things when thinking about doing bioinformatics and genomics work is making sure that we have a good hypothesis and framework for testing it. You can run software on anything you like, and you will get results. And those results may be good or not. And if you don't have a framework that you're putting them into, then it can be difficult to discern what those results mean. So I want to start with looking at this general concept called immune modulation and thinking about ancestral human populations and then industrialized, very recent human populations. And I'm going to compare these two. So what we think may have been ancestral and what we think or what we do observe in our industrialized environment. So one of the things we have good evidence for is that ancestrally, humans were exposed to a high parasite and pathogen load. And so that we didn't have antibiotics, we didn't have sanitation. And going forward, these parasites and pathogens are constantly assaulting our system. And so to not die of those parasites and pathogens, we evolved an immune response. And we have both an innate and an adaptive immune response that can respond to these parasites and pathogens. One major difference with the onset of industrialization and sanitation and antimicrobials is that we have this strong evolved immune response, but we have much lower effect of parasites and pathogens. So we're not just constantly infected in industrialized modern environments with parasites and pathogens. I'll qualify it. I'm always saying industrialized modern because there are modern populations that are non-industrial that still have high parasite and pathogen loads. And we actually observe that in those modern non-industrialized populations, they actually have almost no autoimmune disease. There's never been a reported case of an autoimmune disease in a modern non-industrialized population that's been studied. But in all of industrialized modern populations, we have skyrocketing rates of autoimmune disease and much higher rates of cancer. Not all of this is due to parasites and pathogens. Of course, we have differences in caloric intake, differences in exercise. There are many other things, but we do know that there's a drastic reduction in parasites and pathogens. But what this doesn't explain is why there's a tremendous sex difference. So approximately 80% of people with autoimmune disease are women. So there's a huge female bias in the rates of autoimmune disease. And also we observe that women experience lower rates of all non-reproductive cancers other than thyroid cancer than men do. So it seems like there may be a trade-off in terms of immune function, so increased risk for autoimmune disease in women, potentially offsetting a lower risk in cancer. This is very broad, but why on earth do we think that would be? And what we're proposing, is that ancestrally, in addition to having a high parasite and pathogen load, there was also high parity. So there's no contraception. So half of the population, approximately, who could get pregnant was exposed now to parasites, pathogens, and a genetically distinct individual in terms of the placenta and pregnancy that needed to be tolerated for the length of the pregnancy. And so the immune system in individuals who could have a pregnancy needed to be able to not expel that genetically distinct pregnancy. But if you completely downregulate the immune system in response to the placenta, you'll die of parasites and pathogens. So we need to find some balance. And we think that the immune system didn't just systematically downregulate in pregnant individuals, but rather that some components needed to downregulate to tolerate the genetically distinct individual, and others needed to still upregulate in response to parasites and pathogens. So it's not just a one-way thing, which is why we have this general concept of immune modulation. However, in industrialized modern environments where you are not pregnant from the time you're reproductively active until menopause, individuals will more likely have 2 to 3 pregnancies per lifespan, although it can range, right, with many people having none and some people having more. But in modern non-industrialized populations, for example, in the Chimane in Bolivia, women will have on average 8 to 9 children per their reproductive career. And it's much lower in industrialized populations. And so we think that in addition to reduced parasites and pathogens, the reduction in the number of pregnancies over time is is something that our immune system, our evolved immune response, is not prepared to deal with. And here's where we pause and we talk about the naturalistic fallacy. Just because something is the way in which we evolved does not mean it is the good and right thing. So just because we evolved in an environment that had no sanitation and high parasite and pathogen load, that doesn't mean that today I suggest you all to, you know, go lick the stones and don't wash your hands when you go to the bathroom. It also doesn't mean that in an ancestral environment without contraception, because our immune system evolved that way, doesn't mean that the good and right way to be is to be pregnant your entire reproductive career. It just means that's how it was. This is how it is. Evolution is slow. So let's talk about evolution a bit more. So these are a bunch of mammals that were sequenced at the time I got my PhD, or at least genetically analyzed in some way. And I want to talk about three different features of mammalian evolution. So the first is just broadly, how did mammals evolve? So I'm going to orient you relative to birds. So all of these monotremes, marsupials, and eutherians, we all as a group diverged from birds about 320 million years ago. And then the monotremes, these are mammals that still produce milk, they still have hair, but they lay eggs. They diverged from the rest of marsupials and eutherian mammals, or us, about 177 to 200 million years ago. And then marsupials, so these are largely in Australia, we do have North American marsupials, and the eutherians, which are humans, dogs, cats, whales, dolphins, cows, pigs, mice, we diverged from marsupials about 160 million years ago. So I'm orienting you to this phylogenetic tree so that I can show you the evolution of reproduction along this also. So we see that with the evolution of these different major mammalian lineages, we also have a shift in gestation and development. So birds form these hard shell eggs, monotremes, both the platypus, and there's five species of echidnas, they lay eggs. They're soft shelled eggs, and they either lay them in a den, like the platypus, or the echidnas actually have kind of like a fatty pouch that sometimes they'll let their eggs sit in. And in the common ancestor of all marsupials and eutherians, we shifted to this first stage of internal development. So rather than laying eggs external to the body, the eggs are fertilized internally. Marsupials do form a placenta for just a few days. It interacts with the maternal body, but it doesn't last for very long. And then this kind of little jelly bean sort of critter is birthed. And if you've never seen a kangaroo birth, you should definitely YouTube it later. It, you know, it's birthed and then it has to crawl up the fur and then reach into the pouch and then connect to the nipple. And it gets most of its nutrition via lactation. Eutherians are a bit different. We actually have a very, what we call a fully formed placenta. It develops within the first few days of gestation, just like a marsupial placenta, but then it persists and it grows quite large, and it's the site of oxygen and nutrient transfer between the developing embryo and the maternal body. It allows for a much longer internal gestation. Okay, and then here's where genetics gets really interesting, because we also have a very coincidental or potentially causal change in our sex chromosome evolution. So birds have what's called a ZW sex determination. When we say XY for mammals or ZW, all that means is ZW means it's the egg layers that can produce an egg with one of the two different kinds of sex chromosomes. And if it's XY, it's the sperm producers that make a sperm with one of the two kinds of sex chromosomes. So birds, it's the female egg layers that can determine largely the sex of the offspring. And in all mammals, it's the sperm producers. Turns out monotremes have this really wonderful multi-X, multi-Y sex chromosome system. Males will produce a sperm with either five X's or five Y's. They have 10 sex chromosomes. It's really neat, but in fact, it's completely independently derived from birds or the rest of mammals. So we don't exactly know what was going on along this lineage, but we do know it's just very different than everyone else. Then in marsupials and eutherians, so everyone that has any type of placenta, we have a shared XY system. It's called an X conserved region and Y conserved region. So this kind of open part here. And then in the common ancestor of every eutherian mammal that has this fully formed placenta, we have an addition, an X added region or a Y added region that's about 50 million base pairs that's added to our X and Y chromosome. And this is shared across all eutherian mammals. Coincidence? Maybe. So let's get into this a little more. So I think this is interesting because it's a potential genetic mechanism for why we see differences in gestation, why we see the onset of a prolonged placenta development. So let's talk about sex chromosome evolution. So we know that our X and Y chromosomes were not always X and Y. Between 180 and 210 million years ago in the common ancestor, before divergence of the marsupials and the eutherian mammals, our X and Y were a pair of non-sex chromosomes. So just like we have chromosome pair 1, 2, 3, 4, our X and Y were not distinguishable from each other at all. They weren't sex chromosomes, they weren't doing what they do today. And somehow over about 200 million years, they've become very genetically distinct from each other. So the X chromosome has about 155 million sites on it and 1100 genes. And the Y chromosome used to be very large and it's degenerated. It only has about 60 million sites and 27 unique genes. This is important because it means that there's huge differences in this recombination suppression that we think that led to these two different sex chromosomes. So half of the population has two X chromosomes on average, right? I already told you that there's sex chromosome complement variations, and half the population on average has a single X chromosome and this very gene poor Y chromosome. This is really weird to me because we know that trisomies, so having an extra autosome or an extra non-sex chromosome, at least for trisomy 21 and occasionally trisomy 18, and occasionally a couple other chromosomes, having three copies of an autosome or non-sex chromosome is compatible with life. Having one copy is not compatible with life. So having a single copy of chromosome 1, a single copy of chromosome 21, a single copy of chromosome 18, it's not compatible with life, and yet half the population doing just fine with one copy of the X chromosome. Why? Why on earth? Well, it turns out over those 200 million years, we've evolved a dosage compensation mechanism. So individuals with two X chromosomes actually turn off one of their two X chromosomes in a process called X inactivation. And you can observe this. If you take a cheek swab, you can stain your cells. And if you have a single X chromosome, you won't observe this little bar body on the corner. This is the cell nucleus. So if you have a single X chromosome, it doesn't matter how many Ys, you could have a single X and no Y, a single X and a Y, a single X and two Ys. If you just have one, you won't observe this bar body on the side. But if you have two X chromosomes or two Xs and a Y, you'll observe at least one of these bar bodies on the side of the nucleus. That's one of the X chromosomes that's been covered up, we now know, with long non-coding RNA and forms a ball of heterochromatin. So for a long time, we thought that ball was totally silenced. And so that kind of makes sense. Now individuals with two X chromosomes have one active X and individuals with single X chromosome have their one active X. And we've about equalized dosage between XX and XY individuals. But science is tricky. And not all genes on that silenced X chromosome are inactive. And so this is a picture of the X chromosome. And this is the proximal and the distal end of the X chromosome. And here's the centromere. And this is gene density. And here's for about 844 protein coding genes. Geneticists are always like, 1100 genes, 800 genes, depends on how you define it. But here we're looking at about 800 of these genes. And one of the things I really like to point out to students is, so I already gave you the punchline, not all of these genes are silenced on that ball of heterochromatin, right? But for a full over 200 of them, a full third of them, we don't know. We don't know if they're silenced. We don't know if they're escaping. We don't know what's going on. There's a lot of technical reasons why we haven't been able to assay these, but there's so much left to do, right? There's always more questions to ask. So the first thing I like to point out is that, I'm going to tell you what we do know, but I also want to point out that, I don't know. I don't know what's going on here. And for about a third of these X-linked genes, they are inactive in all individuals in all tissues. They're on that ball of heterochromatin. They've been silenced. We don't see any evidence of the gene expression. And I couldn't have asked for a better presentation to precede this, because the way we look at that is looking at allele-specific expression. Do you see both alleles, or do you just see one of them? So it's like, thank you for partnering us so very well. That means for the other third of these X-linked genes, we see at least some expression from that inactivated X chromosome in at least some tissues and some individuals. Not in everybody all of the time, but about a third of those genes, we do see expression from both the active and that inactive X chromosome. Oh, and then what's really important about this is that, over 50 of them are genes that we know are expressed in the immune system. There's been additional work looking at T cells and B cells in particular, and we see some of these genes are escaping only in T cells and B cells. So they're providing a mechanism for increased gene expression only in XX individuals, not in XY individuals. Additionally, there's 8 of these are tumor suppressor genes that are escaping inactivation in XX individuals and maybe providing a mechanism for the reduced rates of cancer in XX individuals. Okay, so that was very much like may, but let's see what's actually going on. So one of the tissues we're really interested in is the placenta. We know that there are these developmental origins of disease, and along with Tanya Fong, who's a postdoc in the lab, and Kimberly Only, a PhD student, we've been studying patterns of X inactivation in the human placenta. Why this is important is the placenta is the genotype, or it's made of DNA and tissue from the developing embryo. It's not maternal DNA. The placenta is the DNA of a developing offspring. This gets really interesting in terms of ethics and who owns the placenta, and do you have informed consent to do whatever you want with the placenta, right? I guess you can, as a parent, you are the one who has that ability to make the choices, but also, are you eating the placenta? What does that mean in terms of your baby? It gets complicated quickly. But it's fascinating because it is it's a direct genetic interaction between the developing embryo and the genetic mom that can explain why we have sex differences in rates of preeclampsia, in preterm birth, and in other health outcomes in our newborn. Okay, so I mentioned X inactivation, but there's 2 levels that we think about it on. Okay. I think I'm doing good on time. One is a whole chromosome level, and one is the gene level. So for the whole chromosome level, it's kind of asking, if you were to swab your cheek and stain it and look under the microscope, if you had a way to say, is that bar body your mom's X or your dad's X that's inactivated, could you tell which one it is, right? And do you have cells with your mom's X inactivated right next to cells with your dad's X inactivated? So it's which choice was made in the tissue you're looking at. So on a big, broad level, which X did your body choose to keep active and which X did your body choose to inactivate? That's one level. The second level is a gene level. So it says, okay, sure, we figured out whose X is active, but on that quote unquote inactive X, which are the genes that are escaping? So which are the genes where we see biallelic expression, expression from both the active and the inactive? And which are the genes where we see this allele specific expression or only expression from the active X and not from the inactive X? So I'm gonna come back to this, but there's 2 levels that we're looking at. One, whose X is silenced and how? And then which are the individual genes that are escaping on that inactive X? Okay, so one is just this first question about patterns of X inactivation. So we know in mice actually mice inherit a paternally silenced X chromosome. And so there, so this is actually the opposite pattern here, where we'd see the X paternal being expressed in all of the tissues. And later they make a random choice in adult tissues. So in the placenta, one observation, our experimental setup is to collect two samples of the placenta from opposing quadrants. And we're going to compare allele-specific expression to try to see if we can see whose X broadly was chosen for silencing in those regions. So one is maybe it's all dad's X that was silenced or all mom's X that was silenced. The second pattern that we could observe is that it could be patchy. So you could have big clusters of mom's X, big clusters of dad's X. And depending on where we sampled, we could, since we're only sampling two places, we could observe both places having dad's X, one place having dad's, one having mom's, or one largely being one parent's X and the other showing biallelic expression, or both, because we sampled a chunk of tissue that's kind of on the boundary. And then the third scenario is that it's mosaic, that cell by cell, you're seeing, you know, one cell has dad's X, one cell has mom's X, one cell has dad's, one has mom's. And so in every sample, if this were the case, we'd observe both parents' X chromosomes being expressed across the entire X chromosome. So to get at this, we're going to do our allele-specific expression analysis. And in particular, we look at allele balance. So this is going to be for an autosome. I'm not showing the X chromosome right now. This is our proof of concept. This is chromosome 8. We better see half or 50% of expression. This is each of the placentas. We better, I hope, right? We better see half from mom, half from dad. If we don't, I have just wasted $50,000. That would be really sad. But thankfully, I didn't, at least not yet. So we see you have equal allele balance at both sites, site 1 and site 2, site A and site B, about half expression of mom's allele, half expression from dad's allele everywhere. Okay, so what do we see in the placenta? I'll show you the first site that we looked at. We see it's skewed. We see almost always, we only see either mom's X or dad's X being expressed. You'll say, is it always mom's or dad's? And I'll say, we had very limited power to detect this actually, because humans, when we actually, we also got a bit about human demography. Humans have a huge bottleneck in our population as a species. We're not very diverse. So it's actually very difficult. Part of why we don't know a lot of individual genes is also makes it difficult to infer parent of origin sometimes, because we have very few genetic variants across our genes that are expressed. So what I can tell you is that at least for one site, we largely see one parent's X. So now the question is, do I see all of these placentas up here? So is it consistent with everyone having the same X inactivated? Or do we see some other pattern where some of them are kind of patchy, or sometimes we see the other parent's X chromosome? Okay, we see both, right? So what we really see is these all three of these patterns. So we see in some of the samples that we collected, it looks like we happen to collect two different sites that both have the same parent's X chromosome. In approximately half of them are two different sites. It looks like we collected maternal X in one site and paternal X in the other. We're getting the opposite pattern, almost exclusively maternal and almost exclusively paternal. And then for these handful here, it looks like the chunk of tissue that we took in some places had a little bit more maternal X, in some places had about equal mom and dad, and then in some places had a little more paternal X being expressed. So this really suggests that when we think about a whole chromosome level in the placenta, it's very patchy, that in most cases, we're getting a chunk of tissue that's largely maternal or largely paternal being expressed. Okay, so then the question is this the same as we observe in other adult tissues? So we compared to, so we have our two different positions. We compared these to the left atrial appendage and the left ventricle in heart data from GTEx, the genotype by tissue expression consortium. And if it's patchy, like we see in the placenta, then we'll see those little dots along one or skewing along near zero. And if we're actually seeing both parents' X chromosomes, then we're going to see those values around 50% like we did for chromosome 8. And what we see largely in the heart is actually that we're getting for most of the heart samples, and I haven't put the numbers here because there's so many subjects, but we see in the heart, most of the samples are not showing skewing. They're showing about equal mother expression of mother's X and father's X in the heart. There's a little bit, there's a few of these samples over here, but for the most part, X inactivation looks to be very mosaic, so we don't get big chunks in each region of the heart. We'd love to be able to do this with two different regions across more regions of human tissues, but those don't exist. So what does exist is we can look at other adult tissues where we have a single representative. So this is everything. This is from the GTEx consortium, ranging from whole blood, thyroid, stomach, esophagus, different regions of the brain, arteries, adrenal glands. It's a different way to look at it, but it's still that allele balance. So rather than seeing those dots along the y-axis near one, I'm going to show you the distribution. So the placenta, right, is still showing this patchiness and extreme skewing. So it's over here at one. And we want to see for this single sample from all of these, do any of them? So we already know heart doesn't. Heart isn't going to be over here. Heart's over here around 50%. Do the rest of these look like they're around 50%? Or are some of them skewed? And the answer is they're all largely mosaic. They're all kind of here. There's a little bit, so I couldn't have asked for a better setup. There's a little bit of reference mapping bias, which is why we're not seeing 50%. But it looks like the majority of the adult tissues are not skewed. There are a few samples here that are skewed, kind of like the placenta, but the bulk of them are showing equal expression of mother and father's maternal and paternal X chromosomes. And I will, the last couple slides will be fast and then we'll have time for questions. So the other is the gene specific. So now we see that both the placenta is very patchy and adult tissues are not patchy, but maybe the genes that are escaping are about the same. The first thing is to look at this, which genes are escaping in the placenta. Okay. To orient you to this, this is 100% of genes are showing escape. So we see biallelic expression. And this is none of the genes are escaping. So they're totally inactivated. Zero percent of the samples. And then here are those that are escaping. Here are those that are variable escape. And these are what we would call largely inactivated. But you can see that we drew these bars kind of arbitrarily. So even though these samples are mostly inactivated, they still have, these are all genes along the x-axis, I'm sorry. These genes are escaping in some people and largely not escaping. And these genes are escaping about half the time and not escaping about half the time. And these genes are mostly escaping, but occasionally they're inactivated. So the biggest take home is that there's just a lot of variation. And it's highly variable across genes. So is that the same with adult tissues? And the answer is yes. So actually, these genes that are inactive largely agree between our adult GTEx tissues and the placenta, and genes that are always escaping tend to largely agree. And then we have kind of a bit of fuzziness. Some genes that are escaping in placental tissue and not in adult tissue. So I'll dig into those really fast. Some people like to look at the individual genes, but there are some genes that are escaping in our placenta sample. So in the purple ones, we're seeing biallelic expression, but we don't see that in the adult tissue. So these three genes, for example, we see biallelic expression in the placenta and not in the adult tissue. And there's two genes where we see the opposite pattern, where we see biallelic expression in the adult tissues, but not in the placenta. These are candidates that we'd like to follow up on to see if they have some particular role in placenta or development. Okay, so exon activation in the placenta is patchy and variable and distinct from adult tissues. And I think I may have talked too slow, but what's also interesting to me is the X chromosome is still only reported in about a third of genomic or genome-wide association studies. So even though we see the exon activation has this very unique pattern, there are genes that are escaping that could be contributing to sex differences in gene expression, we're really not including the X chromosome in our analyses. My lab's doing this in a lot of different ways, but we could get to that. So I guess if nothing else, I guess I want to take home that there are major sex differences in disease. We think functionally these are modulated by the immune system and evolved sex differences in the immune system. We think these arose due to the evolution of placentation and pregnancy, that these are propagated mechanistically by gene dosage on the X and Y, and also modulated through reproductive hormones, and that industrialization can have exacerbated these differences. Okay, so with that, I just want to thank everyone that I talked about already, and my funding, and thank you all for listening.